Thanks. It's nice to be here. I have a couple of public service announcements before we get going. I saw the setup for the Wii Homebrew tool next door, and it looks really good. So if you go now, you can probably still make it. I also have a really sore throat, so my voice may actually give out in about 10 minutes, in which case I will be doing the second half of the presentation entirely through mime, which should be fun for everyone. So PHP 5.4 is currently in the works. Those of you who've been paying attention to the development will know that we've been going through the usual sort of alpha, beta, release candidate process over the last year or so. Alpha 1, I think, came out in about March, and we're now up to release candidate 1. So as with any new release of, I guess, any language, we've got a bunch of new features. It's not quite as headline-grabbing as 5.3 was. You know, you can't really re-implement namespaces, although if we could get rid of the backslash, I would. This is more of a quiet release with just a couple of nice new features, which I shall run through. So let's start with the new stuff. So the big headline addition is traits, and traits are, in effect, solving similar sorts of problems to the way mixins get used in some other languages. Traits are something that I believe we've nicked pretty much wholesale from Scalar. But it gives you basically the ability to intermingle code into classes without actually having to use inheritance to do so. So effectively, I mean, the computer science-y way of putting it is it's horizontal reuse of methods and actually properties as well across classes. What's really happening is that the PHP compiler, when it turns it into bytecode, is just copying the methods defined in the trait and plopping them into the class. This is both a good thing and a bad thing, as we will see. So on a fundamental level, this is about as simple as a trait example gets. So we've got a trait here called hello, which has a method which says hello. We have a class called greeter which uses hello. And then once we've used that trait, we can call any methods or any properties that are defined within that trait in the same way as you would call something that's been defined within greeter. So in this case, if we instantiate a new greeter object and then we call the hello method, funnily enough, it says hello. What's really happening under the hood here is pretty much what I've already said. So given that code, which you've just seen, what's really happening is that the function hello is just getting lifted out and plonked in. And so effectively, the bytecode being generated is very close to what would have been generated had that actually been the code. So when I say it's compiler-assisted copy and paste, it really is. I'm going to work through a more detailed example. Regardless of your feelings on object relational mappers, they're a very common thing out there. And at the moment, the way they pretty much all work is via inheritance. So you have a base class you have to inherit from that gives you a whole bunch of magic to retrieve a particular row from a database, and then you can use that to base your object. Inheritance has never felt like a very good fit to me. Back in the dim dark mists of time, did actually do a computer science degree, and using inheritance in that way has never really fitted with certainly my conceptual model of what an object hierarchy should look like, because there's no real is a relationship there. I mean, a blog post really is not a ORM object. It just that happens to be how it's persisted. So I thought I'd write the world's stupidest ORM as a trait implementation to show how it could be done in another way. So we're going to start off by defining a couple of properties. Now, if you were paying attention a moment ago, you will have noted that I stressed the copy and paste bit. There is a catch here, which is when it says private, it actually means private to all the access specifiers are related to the class that you actually use the trait within. That also means that your property names and method names are actually in the same namespace or the same scope as the class you're using it in. So what you've got to be careful of is if you just call a property, say, cache and db, you might actually have properties called cache and db in the class that you use it in. In that case, PHP, being the wonderful permissive beast it is, will not actually blow up and die. It will give you a strict standards warning only, which a depressing number of developers seem to turn off, and you will just get properties getting clobbered. So I think what's going to end up happening is you're going to see a lot of this where people are going to have to prefix property names and method names, which kind of feels like a step back, to be completely honest, but it is what it is. If you're paying attention, you will also note there's another piece of new syntax in there, which I will talk about later. Okay, so as I said, this is really going to be a dumb wiring. So I'm not actually doing anything very interesting here. So we've got an initialization function, which assumes that we've got a field called ID, single ID. It's not going to deal with composite keys or anything like that. We're just going to use PDO to select from the database and fill out a cache. We're going to define a getter. Because traits are getting copied and pasted in, we can define magic methods and they actually work normally. We'll define a setter, which looks pretty much exactly how you expect. So, I mean, so far, it's just looking like a base class would look for an ORM. It's just the difference is how we use it's going to be a bit different. And I've defined a delete function, which I've made private, or a delete method, I should say, which I've made private so that the exhibiting class... Okay, I'm going to have a little sidebar here for a second. And I really appreciate input from people who use traits and scalar. There have been ongoing IRC debates about what terminology we should actually use for traits to get pulled into classes. I like exhibiting, it sounds biological, but we really don't know, because inherits is kind of the wrong word, implements is kind of the wrong word. So suggestions welcome. Write them on a piece of paper, we'll get a little suggestion box at the end. So anyway, delete is private so that we can call it from within the exhibiting class, or the class that uses the trait, but we've got control over whether calling code can actually delete like that. It may have to do other cleanup too, particularly if you're using a database that, say, doesn't support foreign key relationships by default, not looking at anyone in particular. And finally, we've used a method called quoteIdent in there in a few places. Because identifier quoting is database specific, what we're going to do here is we're going to make it an abstract function. All that means is that the class has to have a quoteIdent method when you actually use the trait. So it works the same way as a base class in that respect. Alright, so let's actually write some code that uses it. So we'll define a blog, because blogs are good examples. And basically it's like instead of extending from the ORM, it's just one line, use ORM. So we've overloaded the use keyword to mean something within classes. And then from there, within the constructor, all we need to do, because we've got this init method, is just call this init, like any other private method on the class. Now, of course, if we actually try and do this, because we haven't defined quoteIdent, this gets enforced like an abstract method on a base class. So, what are we going to do? Well, we could just define it within the blog class, but that's kind of the wrong layer to do it in, because it's probably going to be standard across all of your database backends. So what we'll do instead, given that fail, is we'll define another trait. We'll call this one ANSI, and this does ANSI SQL identify quoting. We'll also do an implementation for the special databases out there that don't like the standard. And then within blog, we can use multiple traits. So you don't get multiple inheritance, but you can use multiple traits. And this actually gives you a great deal of power, without having the problems of diamond inheritance patterns and those sorts of issues that you get in languages to support full multiple inheritance. So we can just use ANSI as well. And in this case, this will now work. We also probably want some way of deleting. Now you'll remember I specified the delete method within the trait as private, so that we had the opportunity to override it within the implementing class, exhibiting class. You see the problem with terminology here. So what we can do this in a couple of ways. We can import the trait, when we use the trait, we can actually just change the access modifier on the method as we use it. And literally just looks like that. So it's just delete as public. And all of a sudden, delete goes from being a private method to a public method. You also have the ability to alias the method. Now you may want a method within your log called delete, in which you do other stuff, but you also still want to call the trait method. Now, if you were extending an object, you would use the parent class and then you would call the method on the parent class. But traits, as I said, are copy-paste. So if you have a delete method in the class, then the trait delete method will never get called. So what you can do instead is you can alias it using the same syntax. So in this case, we rename it to ORM delete. So when the copy and paste occurs, it actually changes delete to ORM delete. And then, again, we can just call it like any other private method within the class. So that's kind of the very quick sort of 8-minute overview of traits. There is quite a bit more information on this in the manual. I mean, this could be a talk by itself, really, and on Monday it was. So The manual is a little bit in a state of flux still. It's there are still elements of the documentation being written, but there are about 10 really good examples in there that basically cover every corner of the syntax. There's a whole bunch of other syntax too. If you've got traits with conflicting method names, you can specify which one wins. You've got various other features within there as well. But that's the fundamental. So you get the ability to use to define things that look sort of like classes, and then you can mix in a non-inheritance-based way. Another new feature we have is closure binding. Now, in PHP 5.3, we added closures and anonymous functions, which were incredibly useful, I found, but with one huge catch, which was that they were completely independent of the object system. You couldn't have a closure within the scope of an object. The best you could do was to have as part of your use list to pull variables in scope. You can pull an object in and manipulate that, but you had no way of natively using an object via this. This has changed in PHP 5.4. So in this case, I've implemented two classes which have a method with the same name which do slightly different things. In practice, you'd probably have an interface or something, but you can't fit very many lines of code on a slide. So what we can now do is we can define a closure which uses this. Now, by default, of course, if we just call this closure straight away, you get an error because this is not defined and you're trying to call a method on it. Just the same as if you tried to call a method on any other arbitrary variable that doesn't exist. But we now have the ability to call methods on that closure called bind2, and we can actually specify which object should be this in that context. So in this case, we've actually created two new closures, which are bound to instances of the greeter and farewell classes. And then we're going to call hello and goodbye. And the result of that, as you would expect, given that they're just echo statements up there, is hello, goodbye. The beauty of this is you can do it dynamically at runtime. So fundamentally, as long as your closure doesn't call anything that's obviously not defined, you can call, as you just saw, heterogeneous classes and objects of different classes, which don't even have to be in the same hierarchy, as long as your API is actually the same, as long as your public interface isn't different between them. We've also made some parser improvements. Arrays have had some improvements for a long time. This has been the pattern. If you want to use just one value from a function that returns an array, you can finally do this. Sorry, that took way too long. We've also got a new short syntax for arrays, which you will note looks remarkably like the old syntax, just instead of array open parenthesis, it's open bracket, and instead of close parenthesis, it's close bracket. There were some suggestions for making the associative version more like JavaScript, but it doesn't make a lot of sense for PHP, because PHP has this very solid array object distinction that JavaScript doesn't. So in the end, I think it was really decided it would just be too confusing. Objects can also now, this is actually really new, this only came in the last beta. If you have a temporary object which you just want to call one method on, you can now just define it in line like a sense below O language. And you can actually call format on that object. There's also been some speed improvements. When I did a talk in January at LCA talking about PHP developments in general, and one of my bullet points for this, and I didn't do my own benchmarks, I was trusting other people, was that PHP 5.4 was going to be 5 to 10% faster in general use cases. I've actually gone away and done my own benchmarking now, and it's not miles off from the truth. Basically, everything's a little bit quicker, except for Joomla. Why is Joomla slower, I hear you all ask? Well, I had a look into it. It's actually not that the language itself has gotten any slower. It's that there are a couple of new notices and strict standards warnings in there for really horrible coding practices you shouldn't be doing, and Joomla happens to generate several thousand of those each request.
Out of curiosity, what version of Joomla?
That was the current stable, whatever that was, which I don't have to hand. It was. I literally did this on Monday, so it was whatever I could download.
Yeah. There's a lot of nasty.
Yeah. Sorry, Joomla people. But in general, PHP 5.4 is a bit quicker. It's not tons quicker, but you get a little bit more. The raw numbers obviously here are terrible, but that's because I was doing this in the VM. So you get that. Other minor improvements. The short echo tag is always available. There are binary literals to go with hex and octal literals. They'll be more useful than octal, at least. And there's a new type hint called callable, which, unsurprisingly, enforces that your variable is actually callable. We've also removed a few things. Safe mode is gone. Hooray. Register globals is gone. Hooray. Magic quotes, quite late in the piece, actually got slayed. In about beta 1, it didn't look like it was going to happen, and then some extremely good-looking, persuasive agitators within the project decided that they would just continue annoying people until it got removed. So we'd actually killed magic quotes, which should have happened a long time ago. Computer break and continue went too. Yes, we had our own version of computer go-to in the language. Call time passed by reference, which has been deprecated for, I believe, 6 years at this point, is actually gone now. So you can't do this anymore. You have to specify that it's by reference in the function prototype. The SQLite extension has also been removed. It'll be going to Peckle, where it will probably bitrot for the rest of eternity, like everything else in Peckle. So any functions beginning with SQLite will not be available. The reason for this is simply that SQLite2, the underlying C library, has not been maintained for several years at this point. So we were getting increasingly uncomfortable with shipping something that was potentially quite vulnerable to security issues. SQLite3 actually has a really similar interface, so that should not be a terribly difficult migration. Or you can use the PDO SQLite driver, which in a case of remarkably confusing naming has always been SQLite3. Other things that got removed, the old set, really old PHP 4.1 and earlier session functions finally got removed. Use the session array instead. There's nothing more to that. There are a few gotchas in terms of upgrades. The default character set, which you've always been able to set in php.ini, for some reason that's never made much sense to me, has now been changed to UTF-8. It's always been ISO 88591. You can, of course, set this back. You can just set default char set to ISO 88591 if you want to in php.ini, and life will continue as it was before. All this really affects in practice, though, for most people, is the content type header that you actually get out of PHP as part of your response. My advice is actually don't even think about what default char set is set to. Just set the header on every page request. I mean, you know what character set your page is in, and if you don't, you've probably got bigger problems anyway. So just send it and be done with it. E-all, the error level, now finally actually is all again. Somewhere along the line, it actually diverged just ever so slightly and didn't include, I think it included deprecated in 5.3, but it definitely didn't include strict. So it now includes strict as well. This is a good thing. And you should be developing with E-all on, realistically. Crypt has a minor backward incompatible change for users who have passwords with the byte 255 in it. In practice, given that UTF-8 doesn't even have that as a valid byte, you probably won't run into this, but if you, for some reason, really desperately need the old behaviour, you can use 2x as the prefix instead of 2a, and you still get the old behaviour. There's also 2y and 2z, which are not documented at all. They have a cryptic comment in the code, and I have no idea what they do. The MySQL extension now uses MySQL ND, the native driver by default. In 5.3 it was bundled, but you had to explicitly enable it. In 5.4 it's now the other way around. If you want to use an external MySQL client, you now have to specially enable that. The support for time zone guessing has been removed because it never really worked very well. So as the warnings have been telling you for about the last 4 years, you must specify your time zone in php.ini. And in spite of what a lot of people, including myself, said at the start of the year, APC will not be bundled with 5.4. It just wasn't really ready for bundling. It may actually come in further down the track in a future point release, but it wasn't really ready for this first release. I'm going to rip through deprecated features because there aren't any. E-reg survived in 5.4 somehow. I wanted to kill magic quotes and e-reg, but I only got my way on one of them. MySQL has been what we've called soft deprecated. So there's no actual deprecation warnings being issued for the old MySQL extension, but we're going to actually call it deprecated in the manual, and in a year's time when 5.5 comes out, it will really be deprecated, and you will get deprecation notices when you connect using MySQL Connect. The reason for that mostly is just that Oracle and MySQL AB before that haven't actually maintained the MySQL extension for a number of years. They want people to move to MySQLi or PDO. So, and given that, and the other problem with EXT MySQL is that there are so many terrible tutorials out there that just string concatenate code, you know, post data in and get data in, and, you know, maybe work by accident by virtue of magic quotes if it's all out in one. So the other reason to deprecate it, besides the fact you shouldn't really have four APIs for the same thing, is basically just so that those tutorials will at some point no longer work, or will at least scream very loudly when you try and use them, and hopefully at that point people might get introduced to prepared queries and placeholders and all of those lovely things that everyone else has had for about 15 years.
Yay.
So, when is all this going to happen? Soon. Release Candidate 1 came out last Thursday. The next release will be next Thursday. I can pretty much guarantee it will be Release Candidate 2 because there have been a few bugs reported that probably need squashing before a final. I'd say at this stage, if you twisted my arm behind my back and nobody watches the video later, I'd say final will be the second week of December at a guess, but please don't hold me to that. PHP 5.3 will be supported until at least July. I've got a feeling it'll be a bit longer because it's a popular release and it was a major release, but we'll see how we go on that front. 5.5 will be branched early next year, and I suspect we'll be calling for RFCs in about March. So if you've got some sort of language feature you desperately want to get in, maybe start writing some RFC goodness. Please help us by testing the release candidate. Make test results are probably less important than testing your own code at this point. We really need people to test real-life code with this and report bugs, because that's really kind of the next step. You know, if there's some sort of show-stopping bug that the test suite's not picking up in 5.4, we'd really like to know before 5.4.0 goes out the door. And I'm done. Questions? And I think I've only got a couple of minutes, so let's make good ones. Yep.
Yes, in the way it's handling arrays, there was a problem with an array, assigning an array where the array is a property of an object.
Yep.
Directly, has that been fixed?
As far as I'm aware, it has been. I don't even think... Which specific issue is it?
Well, if you've got a property on an
yep.
object,
yep.
And that property is an array,
mm-hmm.
can you assign directly into it
yeah,
on
absolutely.
The left-hand side?
Yeah, absolutely.
In 5.3?
You should be able to. Okay, interesting. See me afterwards.
Because I've got code here which I say, you know, that I specifically said, you know, fixing 5.4 when it comes along. I believe that this was going to be fixed, and so I just keep doing the workaround.
I'd be interested to have a look at that after the talk. It should already work, so if it's not, then I'd like to track down why. Anyone else?
Here's a little present for us. Some coffee and a cup.
Thank you very much.
Everyone can thank you.